Yeah, so the so thanks for having me here. This looks like an exciting conference. I'm happy to be here. The title that I was given was How Empirical Evidence Does or Does Not Influence Economic Thinking and Theory. And I took that title perhaps even more literally, because what I want to do is to describe empirically, perhaps give a sketch of how I believe empirical evidence has actually been influencing economic thinking and theory, and let you draw the thinking and theory about that empirical evidence itself. So I'm going to be here preaching what should be done, perhaps a little bit, but not much. And I'm trying to paint a picture, and you have to draw the conclusion from that. All right. And I want to do that by going first through, you know, what amounts to bird's eye view. You know, what is economics all about? How is economics done? And then I want to go into some specific cases that are chosen to be, you know, somewhat provocative and simplistic, really. But that's what you can do perhaps in 20 minutes. All right. So the first point is, you know, what is economics? So Fabelin is supposed to have said that economics is what economists do, and that's, you know, arguably true. But that's, you know, that's not very helpful. You know, the first point that I want to make is that we now agree that economics, you know, to a large degree, is a science. And that always was, there was much of a debate about that, dating back many years ago. The way we understand economics as a science now is that economics is positive economics, and Milton Friedman has said that positive economics is in principle independent of any particular ethics position on a normative judgment. And John Neville Keynes, who is the father of John Maynard Keynes, has said it describes what is as opposed to dealing with what ought to be. So it tries to describe events rather than prescribing choices. Now, from positive economics, you can actually derive normative implications, right? We can, you know, lay down a welfare function, for example, and derive normative implications from it, but it's sort of a, you know, almost a secondary thought, if you like. And in science, in economics as well, there are always two approaches, time-honored approaches, right? You can go from theory to data, right? You can deduce what ought to be out there, or you can go let the data speak and think of theories that might reflect this data and do an inductive approach. And many of the debates that one hears, you know, where people are fighting, you know, you should only do natural experiments and that's the only thing that counts, or you should write down a general equilibrium theory first and then you know, look at only data points once you have a clear understanding from the theory. Many of these debates remind me of this fight about which one of these two approaches is right, and both are right, right? So science has always used them. In fact, that dates back to many years. It goes back to the Methodenstreit of Karl Menger from the Austrian school, the inventor of marginalism, and Gustav von Schmoller, the historical school, which I want to cite here maybe for the empirical approach, although Gustav von Schmoller has actually gone beyond that and said, you know, history doesn't repeat itself. You should only, you know, look at historical episodes. There's no sense in looking at stationary processes. So that idea was out there, you know, for a long time too. So you know, we are, you know, what we are seeing in the last couple of days is at least 100 years old in terms of the debate. So in terms of the influence of empirics on thinking and theory, there are always these two different approaches. You can go from theory to data, and you can go from data to theory, and that's a time-honored approach in science, and we should be keeping at it. Now, economics is also an art. You know, physicists dream of a theory of everything, of a grand unified theory. If you actually look at what physicists dream about, it's pretty pathetic. They, you know, they don't explain why there are wars, you know, why we're sitting in this room, you know, why they think of unifying some forces, some little particles, and so forth. I mean, personally, maybe I don't care all that much. It certainly doesn't help us understanding financial crisis. And economists don't try to write down a theory of everything. Right? We try to write down theories or do empirical research in order to answer questions. And we try to get it focused, and I think that's very important. So abstraction is key. So in order to talk about art, let me actually show you art, right? So there's a picture of a tree. And it's actually, as a picture of a tree, it's a pretty pathetic picture. You know, I mean, you can do better, right? I mean, you can take a digital camera and go out there and take a picture of a tree, and you get a far more realistic picture of a tree. So many seminars that I go to, or many talks that you can have, you know, people complain that a certain economic model is not realistic. It should be more realistic, right? And so what did this particular artist do in order to advance his art? Well, he concentrated on the essence of a tree, or on the essence of experiencing a tree. So what does that mean, right? Is it sort of showing all the details? So that's a picture that he drew eventually. And we know the artist, right? So that's Mondrian, right? Now that's fantastic art, and it's simplistic. It's abstracting from too many things. It's beautiful. And we're seeking this beauty, and beauty attracts attention, and beauty is what we are looking for. And you know, there are many things that are not on this picture, and that's just how it ought to be. And so economic models are not meant to be realistic. It would be wrong if they're realistic, right? They're not attractive if they're realistic. This goes beyond just Occam's razor that the simplest theory explaining a bunch of facts is the best theory. It goes beyond the admonition that Lars Hansen and Tom Sargent keep us reminding of, that Arthur Goldberg and Bob Lucas has done, that you should be aware of theorists bearing free parameters. It really is a statement of art that, you know, we like small, confined theories where sort of a few things are happening that we can, you know, keep in mind. We admire the beauty and attract our attention and explains a few select facts that we want to think about. And we do that all the time. And that's how we make progress. So what's the influence here of empirics on thinking and theory? Well, if you have a beautiful minimalistic theory, it's not meant to explain all the data out there. In fact, it can't. It shouldn't, right? If you have a theory that you can't reject, it's probably an ugly theory. You don't want it, right? You want theories that are easy to reject, that are obviously false, in the way that the Mondrian picture is an obviously false picture of a tree. So we design these beautiful minimalistic theories in order to match selected facts, and we agree in some ways before and on, you know, the facts that we want to explain, match, and want to think about, and we distort them in doing so. And that's, you know, those kinds of conversations, you know, tend to rule the day of the discussion. Now, economics is also competition. In fact, this conference is a very good example of this, right? We, you know, what we do is we try to convince each other of our latest news idea, right? And you know, we are trying to come up with some new way of thinking, right? We do this all the time, right? There's a conference on new economic thinking, but new economic thinking, academic departments, that's our lifeblood. That's what we do every day, right? So we're trying to convince people, here's a new way of thinking about the problem. You ought to look at that. And we compete for attention. I believe this is more than the paradigm of a scientific revolution that Kuhn has put forth. Right? So Kuhn has pointed out that occasionally a new way of thinking comes around, and it sweeps out the old thinking. The old thinking is dismissed as wrong, and the new thinking shows how to do things right. It really is, you know, new ideas come up and they just struggle for attention, and we engage in rhetoric to convince each other that that's a good idea, as McCloskey has pointed out. And, you know, once we have done that, right, once we are successful in convincing our colleagues that this is an interesting way of thinking about it, why bother in cleaning up the mess that was there before? Right? It's a little bit like songs on the radio. They, you know, once a song is, you know, songs are played on the radio lots, you know, for a lot of time until they stick in your head. Now that doesn't mean the old songs were bad. You know, maybe they were, right? But nobody bothers playing them anymore. They're still around. And so there's this tendency of just adding new ideas, new thoughts, but the old ones are still around. And why do we have these new ideas? Why do we think about new things? Because new facts come along, we want to explain them. And that's exactly what we're seeing in the last 2 days, right? We're trying to explain what happened the last 2-3 years, and there are many theories out there that have been explaining what happened in the previous 40 years, right? But right now they're not that interesting, right? And so that's kind of what's happening. So new theories predict or explain new facts, and old theories stay around. It's not a revolution. They're not. Some of them are discarded, but many times they're not. They have an amazing staying power. All right. Now, economics is also politics, or economics is useful in politics, so there's a side to economics which is practical. And economists, you know, us academics, we like to practice economics as a science, but you know, oftentimes economics is used for advice, right? And in fact, right now the world is looking to economists for providing advice. How does economics as an advice-giving discipline work? I mean, what happens in politics is an intriguing question. And to be honest, there are other people that are much more capable of answering that than me. I can only observe that from the outside. You remember the quote that was quoted yesterday by Lord Turner on Keynes, you know, saying that madmen and authority sort of distill their insights from some scribbler, you know, 70 years in the past, right? I think Keynes was mad at the time that they didn't listen to him, that they listened to people that wrote their stuff 70 years ago. And right now I sort of feel the same thing about somebody who wrote stuff 70 years ago. And I think where I get a peace of mind is that our thoughts will count 70 years from now, right? So there will be, eventually it will catch up. So I think practical economic polythinking is skeptical, actually, of new and logical arguments. And maybe that's just as well, right? Because you can't just take any new crackpot idea on board and run a country with that. It's just very dangerous, right? So there's a lot of conservatism in practical economic thinking. And it's not oriented towards the latest economic thinking theories. There are lots of economic theories out there that have dealt with financial crisis, that have dealt with financial frictions and so forth. Right? We can, you know, there are lots and lots of ideas that would help us in the literature that have been written way before this crisis to think about the current crisis. But they haven't mattered that much on the practical level. And that's just because there's a lot of, you know, inertia on the practical economic policy thinking. Even the DSGE models, it's only now that they're gradually making the inroads into central bank discussions. It's insane to fault them for the crisis. Facts matter a lot in politics. So I believe what politicians really love is cases. You know, has this worked in another country? Do we see an historical episode where there's clear evidence that this has worked? What's the best comparable case? So simple facts matter a lot, I think, in practical economic thinking. And there's in some ways a straight link from empirics to economic thinking there. Okay, so now let me get to some specifics here. Some specific examples to flesh this out. And the first issue that I want to raise is the Phillips curve. Now, the Phillips curve, you could say, is a poster child of how empirical research has actually influenced economic thinking. Phillips published this because he found this empirical relationship in the data. And then it has led to, you know, complete rethinking in economics. And it's just hard nowadays to do economics, macroeconomics, without having the Phillips curve back in your mind. It's just really hard, right? It's just not done. Or if it's done, it's sort of considered crazy or something. So now imagine Phillips had done that now, had tried to write that paper now, had looked at the US data, and he would have had this plot. So here's a plot. This is US data. It shows unemployment and inflation, and he would have submitted this to John and said, you know, I found a tight statistical relationship there. Now my guess is that paper would have stood a good chance of being rejected. It wouldn't have led to the influence that it has. And it's kind of interesting to look at that picture now. It's really hard for anybody in this room to look at this picture again with a fresh eye. It's really hard to say the emperor has no clothes, because we all believe it has. We are seeing, every one of us sees stuff in that picture, right? We just have to look hard enough, right? I mean, that's what we have convinced ourselves. There's a narrative that we tell about this Phillips curve, right? How it has shifted over time, you know, how the dots are connected. So there was a Phillips curve from 1948 to 1959. Fine, you know, the trade-off wasn't exploited. Maybe even from 1959 to 1970. But then over time, it has shifted. You know, the problem of stagflation as policymakers try to exploit that trade-off. You know, inflation has shifted out, unemployment has shifted out, and so forth. It was spiraling to the outside, and then in 1980, with the insight that maybe central banks really can't control long-term interest rates and really can't control long-term inflation unemployment rates. We can control inflation rates, sorry, but not long-term real interest rates, and can't control long-term unemployment rates. sanity returned, you could argue, right? And you got this gradual shifting back. And so now the Phillips curve, if anything, looks flat, right? So unemployment is moving, inflation does not. If you try to get some inflation-unemployment trade-off from the relationship from 1992 to 2000, you would say that with a little bit of extra inflation, you could kill unemployment enormously, and that clearly is a wrong insight from that picture, if you ask me. So in any ways, we can tell these stories of what happens to the Phillips curve, but it's... And you can take more sophisticated econometric techniques to tease out relationships there, but you know, maybe we are just not sure really what the empirical evidence says, right? And so if you admonish the theorists of not taking the empirical evidence on board, you know, are we really sure what the empirical evidence says? Okay. Are prices sticky? Now, many of these new Keynesian models out there, they need sticky wages, sticky price. I think it has been mentioned yesterday that some central bankers argue that we just have to let wages go flexible and then everything will be fine. And so a key parameter, for example, in many of these models is the degree to which prices are sticky, the Calvo stickiness parameter, for example. And people have tried to look at the data, how sticky prices are. And again, many people in this room here, we all believe the prices are sticky, don't we? Right? I mean, so let's look at data. Let's look at the empirical evidence. And this is a picture that I took from a paper from Julio Rotenberg that appeared in the Journal of Monetary Economics. It shows the retail price in a particular supermarket for Nabisco premium saltines, you know, very particular product here. That's the solid line. And the dashed line actually happens to be the wholesale price. So there's some interesting stuff here in the wholesale price or the retail price that I want to get into. It has something to do with the industrial organization there. I want you to focus on this solid line. And, you know, there are a couple of people, you know, that focus, typically men, I should say, that focus on the upper line here and notice that it's sticky. Because when I walk into a supermarket, you know, that's probably the price at which I buy, right? It's sort of the regular price. People that do more shopping than me tend to focus on the sales price. They go when there's sales, right? That's really the interesting price. That's when you want to go shopping. So if you don't buy at the regular price, right, if you're aware where the sales are, that's the red line is the relevant price here is for you. And so let me just blend out all the other stuff. So that's a price series here now for the Nabisco saltines. I just connected the dots from the sales prices. You know that there will be sale every once in a while. It's hard to see a sticky price here. Now, there is more going on in the data than just that, arguably, right? So are prices flexible? Maybe not. But what exactly is going on in the data? The data offers a much richer picture than what our theories would indicate. And so it's sometimes tricky to have the theory ask a question that the data actually answers. Prices are not sticky in the way the theory wants it to. Something else is going on. And we need to understand there's something else in order to inform the theory again. Contraction monetary policy. This is a research problem that I've been engaged in with myself. It builds on the work of Chris Sims, who has argued that, you know, if you want to understand contraction monetary policy, if you want to understand what happens after contraction monetary policy shock, you should take into account all past data because they're influencing current monetary policy choices. And you should also take into account contemporaneous data that the central bank might see in making that that choice. And so then the question is how much information is left on the table that would inform you about, you know, do you actually have a sort of idiosyncratic choice by the central bank that it does something? You know, well, we might say, okay, if the central bank, you know, if Ben Bernanke goes out and says, you know, heck, today I'm just going to raise interest rates, you know, out of the blue, what would happen? Well, presumably, you know, prices the inflation should slow down, reserves should decline. And let's impose that as identifying restriction. If you impose only that as identifying restriction, what can you say about GNP? So here's a picture. What you see about real GDP is you can't say much at all. Okay, so if you try to identify shocks in this manner, real GDP may go up, may go down. Now, most central banks believe that real GDP will go down. If Ben Bernanke did this, you know, he would do something harmful to output. But then the question is, you know, where are these additional identifying assumptions come from, and why are you making them? If the empirical research told you that things were going up for real GDP, would you believe that? I remember a Carnegie Rochester conference where Chris Sims asked Ben Bernanke, would you have presented the results if real GDP went up? And then Ben Bernanke replied, I wouldn't have been invited to the conference if real GDP had gone up in my research. And so I think there's a certain truth to that, right? I mean, we like empirical research to fit our prior theorizing. And we keep on at it until it fits that. And there's a bit of a circularity here. What causes business cycles? Well, that's a key problem. And again, this was driven by empirical research initially. So here's a picture of HB filtered of the business cycle component in real GDP and labor productivity. And if you look until 1980, it actually shifts after that. So I agree that there has been a structural break here, and I think there's increasing consensus building around that. But if you look until 1980, the two things co-moved. And that was a challenge to many of the theorists at the time. It's sort of inconsistent with a demand-driven, you know, if you take a fixed production function and just expand demand, marginal productivity should decline, not go up in a boom. All right, and so it led to the emergence of real business cycle theory that claimed that the production function was shifting, you know, making that consistent. And but the real business cycle theory was calibrated, it was too simple, it didn't have enough shocks, and so forth. So out of that research program, eventually these DSG models emerged that Chris Sims was talking about. And instead of calibrating them, which is too tight, and instead of just estimating them with maximum likelihood techniques that don't put any information that we might have about these parameters in there, there's now a large consensus in the literature that what you should be doing with these models is use Bayesian estimation. So these models are poster childs for the success of empirical thinking and empirical insights on theorizing, right? They're using a wide variety of shocks. They're using sophisticated estimation techniques. And the Smets-Wouters model that I just want to mention here is a model that's now used by many central banks. Many central banks want a model of that type. They want to use it in the monetary policy debate. Again, it's only gradually that these models are actually used in the debates inside central banks, but they're used for projections. They're used for interesting insights. So that's great. I think it's a resounding success of marrying empirical research with theorizing. I completely agree. And it's just now, right, that, you know, that we have reached this consensus, that we have this beautiful device out there. The events, right, the financial crisis destroys the consensus on which these models were built. And everybody now wants, you know, says these models aren't any good, they don't have a financial sector, and you're sort of back to the drawing board. Okay. So let me conclude here. I went through a number of points. Let me not repeat them. Let me just leave them on the slide, and let's just say the summary is this. Empirical evidence influences economic thinking and theory and vice versa, but it does not do so in a textbook fashion. Jolted by new empirical and theoretical insights and subjected to the fickleness of attention, the frontier of our science lurches forward to the unknown territory of ever more profound understanding. If it moves in circles, it hopefully does so on ever higher levels. Practical economics and economic policy follows with considerable distance, and perhaps this is how it has to be. Thank you.
Another Rolex. One question, Roman?
Oh, no, you don't want to uncover it. My friend was saying they missed out the bit when she walks downstairs backwards or something.
Yeah, she goes like, she's in a crab.
Yeah.
She walks downstairs like on an upside down.
Yeah, especially that.
I just wanted to go back to Chris Sims's talk for a second and ask the following question. Since it is so crucially important because it pertains to the way central banks actually evaluate policies. So one of the key arguments for the models used by central banks is that they, as Chris put it, track in an internally consistent way the way expectations form over time. There have been arguments made for, I'll say, over three decades that REH in its assumption that agents are systematically irrational in a sense of leaving profit opportunities on the pavement. So they do not satisfy the basic Chicago principle that when you see $100 and no one picks it up, that's not good economics. That's what REH economics is. So why should we be comfortable that people who are so irrational that their expectations are tracked by models and form the basis for policy? And what is the virtue of having model consistency with expectations that have such properties?
That was serious.
I guess that's a question for me.
I think that was a question for you, yes. Could you briefly? Coffee is waiting.
I don't care. I have done a lot of work on something called rational inattention, which is inherently critical of rational expectations. So it's not that I believe rational expectations is some kind of truth as good as Newton's laws. On the other hand, incomplete knowledge economics, I find a mystery. And I really don't see it as a good starting point for deviations from rational expectations.
Well, that was two different points of view. I think we are already late, and I think we should wish for the next conference to leave more time for discussion. Thank you.